So now we talked about like everything until we got into the topic that you are playing with machine learning, JavaScript, and other things.
Other things.
Yeah, can you tell us about that?
Well, I think, I don't even remember why I got into machine learning in JavaScript in the first place. I think I was just...
Wait, machine learning in JavaScript?
Yes.
So it's not in Python?
No.
The machine learning
part. I mean,
part.
I can do that as well, but this is not that's not what I'm doing at the moment, because I think I got into it when they released TensorFlow.js, which is the main framework I'm playing with. And I just got really into it because it brought machine learning to the browser. So it means that every web developer can now build experiments and learn about machine learning without having to learn Python as well. And because I know that a lot of the times when it was kind of like on my to-do list to learn about machine learning, I had no idea where to go. I had no idea if it was something totally different from web development or not. And then when I stumbled upon TensorFlow.js, then I was like, okay, well, I already know JavaScript, so now I have to learn the concepts of machine learning. And I did a few like video tutorials, and I really realized that it's a huge opportunity for web developers to actually learn about that type of technology and tinker with it. Even if you go to production, you probably will not use JavaScript. You'll switch back to Python, but it still helps you understand what's going on in that space and not have to totally change to learning Python as well. So,
cool. So now that's how you got started. And then what did you do after?
So I started building my own little experiments. So I think the first ones that I built were in-browser experiments. So either using the three features that machine learning in the browser gives you. So either you load a pre-trained model. So if there's a model that recognizes objects, then you can load that in your code and build your little application that recognizes objects with the camera.
Wait. Like, let's talk about models. What does it mean, like, recognizing, and how does it work, and you know, pre-built model, how to do a pre-built model, anything like for people that were in your situation and they want to understand a bit, what does that mean?
So usually there's a few what we call pre-trained model that are open source. So it means that people open sourced already. So they, for example, an object recognition model, it means that people have used a lot of images of objects already labeled. For example, a bottle, and you have like 1,000 images of bottles or phones or things like that. So they've used all of these this data set of images, and they used an algorithm to find patterns in what makes a bottle or what makes a phone in an image. So, and then it produces a model. So when you train an algorithm, it's going to find patterns, and the output is going to be a model that you can use. And the way you use that, it's usually just a file, like a JSON file, and you load it in your application, and then it's going to be able to recognize new objects based on a camera feed or a picture that you upload on your website. And depending on what the model was trained for, it could be object detection, or you have models of...
Is it object detection, or is it bottle detection, the model that you will be searching for?
So object detection. And then inside, you have a lot of different classes that can be predicted. So depending on there's two models that I know that I've used before. There's one called Coco-ssd and one that's called MobileNet. And the difference between the two, I think, is mainly the amount of objects it's been trained with. So I think Coco-ssd can recognize, I think it's 90 different classes. So it's been trained with 90 different objects and thousands of pictures, whereas MobileNet has more. So depending on what you want to build in terms of experiment, then you will use the model that has been trained with more things. But if you want to do... I think one of the experiment that I did was around recycling. And so, well, if I want to detect that it recognizes a bottle, then I know that Coco-ssd has been trained with images of bottles, so I can use that one.
Right.
There's a few open source models that you can find on GitHub. And if you want to get started, it's actually easier than creating your own, because to have good prediction, you need like thousands or hundreds of thousands of samples. And like you might have, I mean, I don't know if everybody has a data set of hundreds of thousands of samples of images, but if you can find a model that has already been trained, then you can just use that and go on and build your application without having to learn how to, what algorithm to use or how to transform the data. You can do that a bit later, but the first step that I would advise would be to use a pre-trained model just so you understand a little bit what's going on, and then you can move on to do a few more things.
Now, if we talk about what do you think are the opportunities of using like machine learning in a web app? Like, why would you use it? Like, if people, what kind of ideas it brings to you?
So I think at the moment, most of what I've seen were more experiments. I'm not sure. Well, actually, there is one thing that uses, so one framework called Guess.js, which uses machine learning to look at how people, to kind of do predictive fetching of data. So depending on how people go through a website, so what they usually click on next, you do prefetching of where, or predictive fetching of where most people go on the website. So mm-hmm. for performance or things like that, that is really useful. Otherwise, for the in general, yeah, it was more experiments of people playing around with the technology. But where I see it being really useful is in terms of education, if you want to learn about machine learning without having to learn another language, then using JavaScript is really good.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you want to prototype something fast to just validate an idea that you have, if you want to spend more time or more money on something, that's a good thing as well. And also the fact that, on the web, you can just share a URL and people can share like experiments without having
to. They can play right away with it. That's a good thing about JavaScript is that it's very easy to share and demo, and people can start reviewing it without installing anything at all.
And I think one of the main issue at the moment is that sometimes some models are a few megabytes. So in terms of loading them, that's going to be quite slow. But I think as it improves a lot, I feel like we can probably build more performant web applications with machine learning. And there's probably a few that I like that I haven't come across. So I don't know exactly everything that's happening in that space. To me, it's more exploratory as well. But I'm sure that we can build pretty interesting things with it.
So, but I know that you're also experimenting with hardware devices as well.
Yes. So I then after
let's connect with that.
Yeah. After building, after starting building web experiments with machine learning, I learned more about it, and I realized that most of the time, it's about having data. It's about learning patterns from data. And I know that as I do a few experiments with hardware, with Arduino, particularly in Raspberry Pi, you get a lot of data from that because you get sensors. You attach sensors to a microcontroller, and you can get data from anything, a light sensor or a stretch sensor or a movement sensor. And then I realized, as I get a lot of data from hardware, I can probably train my own machine learning algorithms to create models and build experiments. So the only thing so far that I did with hardware and machine learning was gesture recognition system to play a game of Street Fighter with your body movements. I mean, it was like a prototype, right? But so recording hardware data when I was holding a sensor and moving and doing like a punch or Hadouken or something. I record the data a lot of times, and I train a machine learning algorithm to be able to see new data it's never seen before. So a live punch, and being able to detect that I'm punching, and then connecting that to a game in the browser. So
I hope you didn't have to do that 10,000 times, right?
Not 10,000 times, but a few times. Yeah. But that's why it's like, of course, it wasn't the most accurate it could be because I didn't do it,
No, but the whole experiment is like allows you to understand that you exactly. actually can do it by yourself. It's
exactly,
like,
No,
there's no more mystery, right? In the thing, you understand
and
how it works.
Yeah, and then I made sure to kind of like write a blog post about it because I want people to kind of see what's possible and to be able to play with that as well.
But is it? I don't know. Wasn't it you who is trying like to Or maybe it's something you tweeted about someone, like, I don't know exactly, but I will ask you the question anyway.
Okay.
And you make up for that question.
Okay.
It's something like a device that would detect some waves that the brain is emitting, and then using these as signals to understand, to kind of be able to command.
Mm-hmm.
Is it something you talked about?
I did something like that. There's a few people playing in that space, but that was something I did actually before I learned about machine learning, because I bought a brain sensor.
Mm-hmm.
So it detects the electrical activity that's going through your brain when you think. But the one that I played with didn't give you access to the raw data. You could train it through a software. It recorded the data, and I don't know what kind of machine learning algorithm they used in the background, but you could map the data to a certain command, and then you could interact with
how many commands?
I think they have about 10.
And is it precise?
So it's the whole issue with brain sensors. It's that you always have a bit of latency between the data that's coming live from the sensors, and it's trying to classify all of this data. It should find the patterns that are very similar to the one that you've trained with, like previously before the live recording. So there's going to be a little bit of latency, and usually it's actually quite...
What do you mean latency? Like each time latency, or the first time that you use it, you have latency?
No, it's always, there's always a bit of a delay, because you have to focus quite a lot because I didn't record it enough times. But when you buy the sensor, you can train all of the different commands. So for example, there's...
But, so you do training actually on yourself. It's not the pre-configured training.
It's not the brain sensor. It's not pre-configured. You have to record your own brain patterns when you're thinking about, for example, pushing something in space. Mm. So you select that command, you record data for 8 seconds, and you can repeat it. But I didn't do it 100 times neither. So
it's probably that as well.
Maybe that's why as well. But it was still like, it still allowed me to actually connect that with an interface on the web. So I had to create a JavaScript framework for it, because there was no JavaScript thing at the time. So, but then I got a bit, like, I really wanted to see the raw data, but you had to buy a license, and it was quite expensive. Okay. So I moved on.
How expensive is a brain sensor?
Because I think the brain sensor was, at the time, in Australian dollars, after all the taxes, it was $1,200, which is, it's expensive, but it's not as expensive like as a, you know, hospital kind of system. Mm-hmm. So
and could you get it to be like all the time, let's say, stable and you know, each time being able to produce the comment that you thought of?
It was not always accurate, but I think it was because I didn't train it as often as I should have. To me, it was more like a prototyping thing. And also, it's not always super comfortable, so you know that you're not going to wear it for that long.
Why is it?
Because, so, the sensors, to get enough data, it has to apply a bit of pressure, because it has to go like through your hair and really be against the scalp to get the data. So it applies, all the sensors apply quite a bit of pressure. So at first it's fine, but then when you have this pressure on the same spot for like half an hour, it's quite...
You're scared that you're losing your...
Yeah.
You start being anxious. Or like...
But then now there's a few more brain sensors being available. I bought another one that gives you access to raw data, actually. So that's, but I bought it, and then I realized I don't know enough about machine learning. So then I stopped, and I learned about machine learning, and now I think I'm ready to go back. But and now it's a matter of finding the time to do that.
Yeah.
But that's the whole, that's why it's like sometimes I start playing with something, but I realize, oh, actually, to get to where I want, I need to actually pause and learn about something else and then go back.
But you say, this is very interesting. Like often when you get into some new topic and you feel that you're passionate about, but there's something that stops you, you should not see it as a mountain. You should say, okay, what are the things that I need to prepare until I get that to that target? Yeah. And then one by one, and eventually you'll get there, right?
Yeah, I think, but you have to find something that you're actually really excited about. I think if I wasn't excited about building something, I think I would probably just leave it on the side and be like, I'll move on to something else. But I know that if I bought the sensor and I know I can have access to the raw data, I just need to learn a bit more about something else. Then even when I decided to learn more about machine learning, I made sure that I built experiments that I was excited about. If I was just following a tutorial that, I don't know, gave you learn trends from financial data, I'd be like, that's not really my thing. So I would have probably given up.
Yeah, that's very important.
That
excitement allows you to bear all the troubles that you need to go through to get to learn.
Yeah, because you keep being excited. It's never like a bother, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah,
that applies also like some people want to do. It's a completely different topic, but but like starting sport, and you say like, I should go to gym, but gym is really a lot of motivation. Whereas if you get like to a sport that you really like, then you will do everything for that because
it's kind of like tricking your mind to getting to the same point, but in a way that's enjoyable.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you very much.
No, thank you.